Junior Radio. Whoa. Cutting edges on your stereo. Yeah. Mutabaruka leads the way. So just you let the station play. Yeah. Say your teachings got to hold on me. Yeah. Well, this is Kimani and you're listening to, you know, Mutabaruka. IFM, cutting edge. Whoa.
Firing the pin, always smoking. Lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Mutabaruka.
Never feel like it. Rasta never feel like it. For anywhere I go, I want the world to know. Rasta never feel like it. He give I peace and love to hold I head above. Rasta give I peace and love. So she never feel like it. She never feel like it. Rasta never feel like it. He give I peace and love.
I love Kinshasa. I love Kinshasa. I love Kinshasa. I love Kinshasa.
Yeah, good night. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM. We're there with you next Wednesday. As you might know or not know, this is a special day for Rastafari. Yes. Rastafari all over the world celebrate this day, the 23rd of July. Because it was in 1892 on the 23rd of July that a child by the name of Ras Tafari, Ras Tafari Makonnen was born to Makonnen, Ras Makonnen, and Yeshima Bet Ali. Yeshima Bet Ali, Ras Makonnen, gave birth 1892, 23rd of July, to Tafari Makonnen. So you know him was christening at the church, Haile Selassie. Translated in English, it means power of the Holy Trinity, because it was the church at that time giving names to children. Even I myself, I got a name when I was christened, which we don't use. Maybe if I was supposed to become an emperor, I would use it. But that birth, and subsequent to that birth, on the 2nd of November 1930, gave rise to a movement called the Rastafari Movement. The Rastafari Movement has spread all over the world. At its origin in Jamaica, have its spirituality scattered all over Africa. And we who has been displaced, still domiciled on this former slave plantation island, cry out. And in crying out, we recognize and give birth to an understanding that has surpassed many in this part of the world. The Rastafari movement has given hope to many, many African people in this part of the world. And now we have a light at the end of the tunnel. Emperor Haile Selassie I, Rastafari, today, 23rd of July. And we know that the culture of Rastafari is what has helped to shape the popularity of the movement, the culture of Rastafari. Say we are celebrating Emperor Selassie the first, otherwise known as Rastafari, who gave the former slaves a hope and a salvation and a redemptive philosophy. And with there we did still a go through, a try liberate yourself from mental slavery and from the pangs of oppression that has gripped us in these colonial countries, these colonies of Europe. So we go through with all different kind of things. As we say, the culture is one of the greatest thing we have at our disposal, and we have used the culture very, very good. Nobody can complain. I hear people complain, say, Rasta don't have no hospital, and Rasta don't have no school, and Rasta don't have this. Watch a man. We give the world a different kind of way if you look by themselves. We give black people a different kind of way if you look by themselves. And we give them a sense of pride and dignity, not only in them ear, because some people are going like the ear not important, because it is the Rastafari movement that has popularized this thing that them call locks in the Western world, even though we know that it was existing long, long before Rastafari come up. But it is we, through our cultural expression, that define ourselves. And don't allow other people to define us. We have used what we have to create our own understanding and our own logics. Sometimes it seems confusing, but it is only confused to the people them who is and want to be confused. Sometimes everybody wants to see everybody say the same thing and do the same thing at the same time. But we know that it's a level and a stage. You know, come to the same thing at the same time, same way. There's so many leaves, but there's only one tree, and there's so many rivers, that is one sea. So all those rivers run to the sea, one sea. So when we look at people saying, well, I have too much confusion in a Rasta, I still try to figure out what part of it is the confusion. Because I know a man can't go further with mind there and with intellect there. So when you hear a man say this, and you say, oh, a man said this over here, so, and you come say that over there, so. Well, you have to look upon it and say, well, right now, the way other man that see it in a theme little sphere and theme excitement and theme mind is not our man over there so see it, but ask him, who is the emperor? I hear them tell you. A desolate day, you know. Rastafari. And we not really feel a way to go all over the world and declare Rastafari. We're going to any place, anywhere in the world and say that Emperor Haile Selassie the first. We not add nothing and not subtract nothing. Some people choose to add things. I saw, we sit down here, so. Nah, add nothing to that name. Because nothing can make it greater or lesser. Nothing can make the person greater or lesser than who him is. So you could have picked up name, pant up a name, and ascribe this to him, and ascribe this to him. That make him no difference. You have some people say, Rasta, your God dead. from 1974, 75. Oh, you see that worship dead man. Well, it's a problem that, you know. It's a problem that, you know, why is a problem that? Because the majority of the Western world I worship a dead man were dead 2,000 years ago. And because them can't accept that death, them raise him from dead and put him in the sky. And then expect we, the slaves, to look up in the sky, which what of us have been doing. A lot of us has been doing it, looking up in the sky and still looking up in the sky for that 2,000-year dead man to come to save them from white man oppression. So we, the former slaves, has created a logics that surpass what we were taught in the Western world, because what we do is go forward into time and reconnect with our ancestral origin. That's why we call it heritage. We call it heritage because it connects us to a land. It connects us to a time in history. And it connects us to a place in history. So, the heritage that a whole heap of people search for as Jamaicans and recognize that other people who's amongst them has connected their heritage to a land and to a place and to a time in history. And then gone past way because them never give up that heritage, time and space. We, the majority of African people, has descended into a quagmire of amnesia. Amnesia all around me. As a matter of fact, it's Alzheimer's we have now. Gone past, well, I don't even know which one worse, amnesia or Alzheimer's. But we are, it's like we're dead at the two of them. We as African people can't seem to recognize that the spirituality that defines us do have to base itself in what the Europeans give us. But we, through the need to be free, is able and can be able to produce and create our own viewpoints. Some people will say, it don't make no sense. The only time it don't make no sense is when you start to itch it to something where the slave master did give. The only time it don't make no sense is when you itch it to some concept and some belief system that the slave master did use against we. So when we create our thing and use our thing, we try to justify it or validate it through the eyes of the slave master and the peripheral thinking. The peripheral thinking that was washed by the slave master in Africa, not in Europe, in Africa. Because the Europeans was not the first people to go inside of Africa and create disturbance. Because we know of the Ixos who came out of the Caucasus Mountains and come right into our ancient place called Kemet and subvert the culture. Them Wipa ones don't go for sure, yo. How is it that Egypt, that famous place known as Kemet, that place that was at the top of the world, has now become a footstool for other nations and people and tongues? It is because of the thinking and historical references that has not been shown to the people that we need to examine before we can come to some clarity about what we see as our reality and how Kemet was invaded by outside forces and stripped of its glory, and then it was invaded again by Arabs, and it invaded again by Europeans, and now the Arabs is there. The majority of Arabs in the world live in Egypt, that it is now known as. So we farmer slaves has created something that can and will enable us to liberate ourselves from not only mental slavery, but from cultural imperialism and what we dub white supremacy. Some people don't want to recognize that, but you have to recognize that somewhere or another, that we are under the pangs of white supremacy. That is why most of the things that we do, say, and think, and believe in have to have a clarity within that sphere, that whiteness have to validate our logics. Whiteness, the only thing free us, the only thing sometimes is able to free us, is the poetry. And when we say poetry now, we are talking about songs also, because every song is a poem put to music. So we have to say, the poetry, the philosophy in the poems, in the songs, has been a liberating force to clarify some kind of cloudy understanding of ourselves. The poetry, the songs have been able to open our eyes to recognize who we are. And it was, if it was not for those griots, we would still be trying to use and justify ourselves through the eyes of white supremacy. Because when we look around us, when we look at what is going on around us, we recognize that white supremacy dominates us, even us who claim to be conscious, because we continually perpetuate these ideas that is not liberating us, but is putting us more and more into what we call colonialism, slavery, and spiritual decadence. So, on this day, I want to heal up my mother. Because my mother, who gave birth to me long time ago, my mother is still alive. And she is celebrating her birthday on the 23rd of July, today. So, I want to heal up my mother. I know she's not listening and that she's not hearing, but I know that someone might be hearing and go tell her tomorrow, say, yes, son, I call out you. I say, wish you happy birthday today. I want to tell my mother, give thanks for your womb that carried me, that I could have reached to this point in my life, and use my life to enhance other lives in this world, and not change and not regress. It's just forward, because we're not going to make the path that we have used the cutter to go through with, make it get rusty up. We never lose sight of the prize, and we are going to keep echoing Africa for Africans, those at home and those abroad. We, the farmer slaves who have liberated ourselves and is trying to liberate others who don't know that them is slaves, we recognize that to say Haile Selassie in a country that has been dominated by white supremacist mentality and thinking is a challenge in itself, but we, it's up to the challenge. Because we know that his heritage, his history, his time, and his place that bring us to this point. And we are the memory, according to one intellectual, Barry Chevans. We are the memory of the people of Jamaica, who only, if they knew that they were slaves, they would try a way to get out of it. But because the colonial masters have played it so powerful on them, that we who recognize that slavery still exists is mocked and jeered at. What difference does it make? Why are you bringing up all these long time things? Why you don't just go through, you know, say everybody, a whole heap of people have got through, you hear them attack, well, the reason why a whole heap of people got through and left we behind, the African majority, is because them place themselves. I want you to listen to me carefully, African people. The reason why other races got through is because them place themselves in history, in time, in a place. Check it. Them can tell you about a place. Them can tell you about a historical events or historical events. And them can tell you about them heritage. Heritage, you know. We are talking about heritage, you know. Because we are separate heritage from culture. Because where we have culture, we don't necessarily have to have heritage, because we can create cultural experiences in the place that we find ourselves in that cannot be linked with any of our heritage. Yet still heritage define we deeper than just this little island ya song. That's why other people them, when them define them heritage, even though them wear a certain clothes at a certain time, but when them go into them heritage, the clothes that you see them come out with is not the same clothes that them wear to them work every day. We, the African majority, we go to work in the clothes, and when we come home and say to celebrate, we celebrate in the same clothes that we went to work in. That is sign of slaves. Because slaves can't change them clothes. The same clothes of them working, are the same clothes of them sleeping, are the same clothes of them partying. Are slaves that. The people around me, the clothes that them sleeping, them don't go to work in. And the clothes that them go to work in, them don't go to party in. Them have different clothes for different things. That is heritage. That is knowing your heritage. So when you have Heritage Week in Jamaica, the African majority is confused. Them don't know them confused, because they're not celebrating them heritage. They must celebrate them Jamaican cultural experience that defined them in a space of slavery, chain round them foot and chain round them neck and chain round them brain. That is culture as it is defined in a given space that though have no link to nothing more than the space where you find yourself in at the time. It's just that, you know. We are talking about place, time, space. I wasn't speaking to that about no sky. We don't have no peripheral understanding. Because them come with a peripheral understanding. And we take it up like say it is the main course. We say it's the main course. So everything we do, everything we believe in, have to be validated through the eyes of the ones them who in slavery. So anytime we talk, and we want to talk sensible, we have to talk through the eyes of the ones them who in slavery. That's why Steve Biko said, the greatest weapon in the hands of the oppressor is the mind of the oppressed. We keep reiterating that saying. Steve Biko says that the greatest weapon in the hands of the oppressor is the mind of the oppressed. And when we look at what is happening with the majority of African people that make up this country, you can see what they do to our minds. That everything that we do, everything that we see, everything that we say has to be in line with the logics of the European thinking. And if it is not in line with European thinking, most of us say it don't make no sense what you say. So when you go to a little sister now and you say, "Why am I African princess?" She say, "Me I'm not African. Me never born in Africa." That is what we are talking about. We are talking about African people saying that them is not African because them never born in Africa. But yet them keep saying Chinese man to Chinese people who never go to China yet. How the hell a Chinese man is a Chinese and never go to China yet? Simple. He's connected to a place, he's connected to a time, he's connected to heritage, and you recognize that. You Jamaican, we call yourself Jamaican, you recognize say the man is not of you, and you have to identify him in the space. Even though it's in your space, you have to identify him outside of your space to a next space that is far, 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 far away. But the only way you can define yourself is in the space that you find yourself in that is not of your own choice. You never chose to come here, whether through your mother or through slavery. I never asked my mother to come here. Through some pleasurable experience from my mother, I came here. I never have no choice. And at a greater existence, my great-grandmother did not ask to come to Jamaica. We were brought here. Some of us get dropped off at some other country. Some get dropped off over there, so some get dropped off over there. So. But when we come here and when we look and we are gone, we feel that there's nothing else that exists but what is here in this space. So we celebrate that exists but what is here in this space. So we celebrate what is in the space that we are at the moment. Rastafari, come break that chain then now and say, "Look here." Mm-mm. No, sir. Even though I'm in that space, I'm in the space but not at the space. Step back. May I create something? That's why we say I and I. And people say, "You never got school where I and I." Say, "Born you and born me, I and I." The man say, "Then when you see I, you know, see I, listen, I see I, man." And then you hear a man around the corner and say, "Jesus." He said, "No, Jesus, no, sir. Janakin's ship. It says Jesus of Rubeca, Jesus bring a command here, so." The man said, "Where you get that from?" He said, "He should teach I that." That's a man go around him chalice and puff up him river and smoke out the place, and him say, "Yes, you think you can't see I in the cloud? I disappeared in the cloud of smoke." and you crucify yourself and you try to crucify I. And the thorn that you put upon your head has now become a crown of rejoicing. So you can't really fool I. But there is always a but, that you can't, you can't trick I, you can't fool I, because there's some of I and I who still choose to maintain the ideas that has been exposed on us by the slave master. So when you say locks, man look upon the locks and say, dread, terrible. What if you go to your ear, so? But then him started to feel me, so no, but him make you, him catch you now. Because meanwhile, I like a white guy now. I make him locks grow. And him locks tick up like all a tree, like all a mango tree. Where you see? We now have to find a way now to unravel the locks by creating some other method and way to make it don't look like locks. Meanwhile, the white guy around is so not doing nothing. Even though film won't take longer for locks, but when you look on film one, it reminds you of the ancient Haya Congo, where I come out of the bush, them are Hanover, and Westmoreland, and St. James. And when you look on the little locks, them you so now them twist up, twist up, twist up, twist up, like whist with Tarzan used to swing pan. Because they so them put way. Even though we say we are finding ourselves, but we have to find ourselves in context. And the context that we're finding ourselves with is in the context of white supremacy. So white supremacy now, even though it allow the locks, but it give us another way to do our locks, to make it don't look like locks. Meanwhile, the white guy in Italy, in France, in Germany, I look like, oh, we should have that look. But because we look on our own ear and say, why the ear look too natty, Congo? No, sir. You know what I mean? It looks so. We have to find a way to don't make it look like how it's supposed to look. Lightning. This is the cutting edge at IRFM. We're there with you. Yeah, this is the cutting edge. As we say, we're upon it the 23rd of July. But we just share some philosophy and views with the ones them to recognize how important it is that we find ourselves. And the only way we can find ourselves is go forward in ourselves. And the only way we can go forward in ourselves is if we identify ourselves with a place. So we did I tell you about a little girl who, when you tell her that she's African, she says she's not African because she never born in Africa. But she can recognize a Chinese who born in Jamaica, who call himself Chinese and call himself Jamaican. But she only call him Chinese. Because you have some people in a Jamaica, yeah. And this is a serious, this is something where I experience in a Emancipation Park, a function I keep in a Emancipation Park. And a little sister who me love dearly because I see her all the while and she have a little youth. I don't know if she use a little youth to get sympathy. But not that we had argue about, but she in the park and men are attack. I'm saying, you know, we just attack about thing, and she said, why don't turn it rough and all every way there. And so you know, she about the thing she have to come up here. So if somebody ever pass me now who well brown, I'm introduce her to the person and say, this sister here come from uptown, so you know. She say, she a no Jamaican. She a white woman. I mean say, but you know, she a no every Jamaican black like you, you know. She said, no sir, me never seen a Jamaican white. So you know why she said that? Because she not get exposed to uptown. So she feels say every Jamaican look like the person with the which the monks. In the ghetto. She not left the ghetto at all. It's like she have some people in at St. Elizabeth when not left St. Elizabeth. Them don't know how far it, them don't know how Kingston said, them don't know how Negril said. Believe it or not. I see them same people were in St. Elizabeth, if them ever go a certain place in Jamaica, people that feel them are tourists until them talk. The point I am making is that Jamaica is a small area and a small group. We are a whole heap of we buck up. We buck up by accident. Not by choice. We buck up by accident. So everyone away must connect to a land space, a land. If we don't connect to no land, I mean, I talk about the land where them bring upon, not by free will, then we're going to be complicated in finding ourselves as a people. And that is where them take out away. Them take out, them take away from the land. We are the only group of people right now that when we get enslaved, they move you from your land. So we have to find we land, we have to find back a culture in the land where we're there. I'll find back a culture where in the land where them take we from. But here we know, we maintain the culture in the land where them put we in. And the land where them put we in, the culture that them give we is adapted to their thinking to keep we in subservience to them. And then them bring some bossy slave over we. We say them are govern way and them are rule way by a system where them create again named democracy, by a system where them create named Christianity, and we now accept it as the only reality to solve our problems. It is the only reality we have to solve our problems. So the Rastaman become a stigma, a outcast. But we never afraid for the black heart, because we say we are black. And you know, in another time, if you say you are black, you're in a serious problem. But we persistently say black heart, man. Is the Cutting Edge and IRFM there with you. 23rd of July, as we say, is my mother's birthday. 23rd of July is Emperor Haile Selassie I Earth Day. So we celebrate it because we are Rasta. You understand? And if we depend on the radio and we have this at our disposal, why not? Yes, why not? We have to celebrate it. You can just imagine if me, the depend on a radio station. And when the 23rd of July come, them tell you, say, boy, I don't want you to mention too much about Rasta today, even though it's a... And of course, anyway, we're glad to be the Pirate FM. We're glad to be the Pirate FM, because, trust me, you have some radio station, you know. You can't go talk about Haile Selassie I Rastafari on them station, you know. You think I joke? At 20th station in Jamaica, you have a radio station, you have some radio station, not a radio station, and one of them. You have some radio station in Jamaica. You can't say Ja Rastafari Emperor Haile Selassie I on them station. You understand? So we give thanks to you over there. I will feel irie. Okay. So in keeping with the celebration of Haile Selassie, we want to play this tape here. You know, we have played for years, but we keep playing it because you have people who hear it and never want to hear it again. And you have people who never hear it yet, because we have a whole heap of listeners and listeners tonight that we never hear it yet. And we have a whole heap of people who never listen to it. And when them hear it, so we play it, they're going to say, what? You know, somebody don't want to hear it again. So here goes now. You ready for it? All right.
These people are waiting for the appearance of a living legend. Ministers of government, ambassadors and their wives, princes of the church, By now, they've probably lost count of the number of times they've waited here at Addis Ababa Airport for the same extraordinary man. In a moment, he'll step from the door of this aircraft to a scene that's even more familiar to him. And here he comes, the legend in person. One of the world's best-known figures and faces, and one that most of us know least about. Father figure of modern Africa and relic of a vanishing world, feudal despot and reforming monarch, one of the last claimants to the divine right of kings, the legendary descendant of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, elect of God, King of Kings, Emperor of Ethiopia. Haile Selassie celebrated his 40th anniversary as emperor, and his own people of Ethiopia came to do him honor. But Haile Selassie in his time has been far more than just the ruler of a small African state. He's become one of the great survivors of our day and of yesterday, riding out in shrewd triumph all that the 20th century could throw at him. Today, Haile Selassie is courted by all the world. At his anniversary reception, the representatives of 100 nations came to salute the authority of this tiny old man. Probably the first African leader to be treated by white men as an equal, and the first to be sacrificed by them in the name of appeasement. He's learned to trust nobody, except perhaps his dog, and yet he's won the respect of the world, for there's no man alive today whose life has spanned so much. Now, in his old age, he's practically the incarnation of the history of our time. Began for Haile Selassie in this remote corner of the Horn of Africa in 1892. In London, Queen Victoria had celebrated her golden jubilee. In Africa, the colonial powers were carving up the continent. But the world Haile Selassie was to grow up to had not been dreamed of. He was born in a thatched hut and christened Tafari Makomon. And though he was of Ethiopia's royal blood, his childhood on these hillsides was as carefree as childhood should be. Ethiopia to the world then was not much more than an African fairy tale. In European romance, it was the land of King Solomon's mines, Prester John and the Queen of Sheba, the place called Abyssinia, where the tribe of the Habashan was supposed to live. Only a handful of foreigners had reached its interior and found among its mountains the source of the Blue Nile. The rest was as dark as anything in darkest Africa, hidden by giant mountains from the deadly curiosity of the world. But Europe's romance was Ethiopia's living history. There was a rich empire here when most of Europe was in darkness 2,000 years ago. Its ruins still stand at Axum, its first capital. And the title of its first rulers, King of Kings, is that of Haile Selassie today. The empire's history since then is a rich confusion of fact and legend. There are still 50,000 people like these in Ethiopia who call themselves Jews of the House of Israel and claim descent from the first Jews out of Arabia 3,000 years ago. They observe the Jewish Sabbath and mark their pottery with the Star of David. Like Haile Selassie's imperial crest, the star crowns the Lion of Judah, the central Ethiopian symbol, begotten from Sheba, who bore a son to King Solomon and called him Menelik, the first Ethiopian emperor. But the central tradition of Ethiopia is Christianity. Long before most of Europe was converted, the empire was a pillar of Christendom, whose emperor earned another title that Haile Selassie carries today, the Elect of God. The echoes of 16 centuries of Christianity sound with undiminished faith through Ethiopia's churches now. Ethiopia was a sort of barbaric Byzantium, and a crusading church as well, bestowing the light of Christ upon the heathen tribes. But like other crusaders, it was beset by the growing power of Islam. From over the Red Sea, the Arabs swept into Africa with their own revelation. Soon, Ethiopia was a Christian stronghold surrounded by the Muslim world. From the Muslim invasion, the emperors and priests of Ethiopia kept the Christian faith alive. Here in the 12th century, the emperor Lalibela carved out of the rock the churches of what he hoped would be a new Jerusalem. It was the empire's capital for 100 years and came to be known as Lalibela after its creator. 800 years later, Haile Selassie was to come here to pray for deliverance from Italy's invasion of his country. At the worst moment of his life, it was his way of declaring his ultimate faith in the God who was so essential to his empire's tradition. A tradition that the monks of Lalibela still voice in a haunting mixture of orthodox plain chant and African rhythm. Christian powers of Europe sent emissaries to the emperors to help them against the Muslims. One of them may have been Prester John, some Western Father Jean, perhaps, exiled and forgotten here for a lifetime. But in spite of Western help, many of the empire's provinces were overrun. The emperors themselves became nomads, wandering the highlands from camp to camp, until here at Gondar in the 17th century, they came to rest again in renewed splendor. These castles of Gondar are unique in Africa. Probably some Portuguese helped to build them. Possibly Indian craftsmen were brought in. But they're a sign of Ethiopia's special distinction in Africa as a place where the non-African world made some early mark on the continent. Yeah. was only a brief revival of a declining empire. In another 100 years, the court was on the march again, still carrying the Christian banner, but challenged at every step by powerful feudal barons, as the kings of medieval England used to be. Only the church held Ethiopia together, and gradually authority shifted again towards the church strongholds in the central mountains. Here, the empire that Haile Selassie would inherit began to take shape under King Sahle Selassie, his great-grandfather. King Sahle was one of the most powerful barons, and it was to him that the new commercial empires of 19th century Europe came with their gifts and guns. And his kingdom was the foundation on which the Ethiopian Empire was rebuilt. Its revival was heralded by a Christian crusade, led by a man who was half monk, half warrior, and who defeated all other contenders for the throne, the Emperor Theodore. But in 1862, Theodore fell foul of Queen Victoria. By a misunderstanding, she failed to answer one of his letters, and in a huff, Theodore imprisoned a British consul and some European missionaries in his mountain fortress at Magdala. When 5 years of diplomacy failed to secure their release, the British at last sent a military expedition to recover them. It was a ponderous exercise, but effective. With elephants, gun carriages, and Indian sepoys under the command of General Napier, they clambered steadily into the mountains that had been Ethiopia's best defense for so long. The Ethiopians were no match for them. They had few rifles and no artillery to save their old empire from the new world. As Napier's army approached their last stronghold, Theodore shot himself. The new concept of empire had triumphed over the old. Yet in Theodore's medieval crusade, there was a glimpse of a new Ethiopia. And 20 years later, under the Emperor Menelik, grandson of Sahle Selassie and half-uncle to Haile Selassie, that glimpse became something like reality. Europe's scramble for Africa was then in full swing, and as the Western empires planted their flags all over the continent, only Menelik's Ethiopia seemed able to stand against them. At Addis Ababa in Sahle Selassie's old kingdom, Menelik created a new capital for his empire. It was Ethiopia's first permanent capital since the heyday of Gondar, 200 years before. Menelik's palace is still used 80 years later by Haile Selassie, and to him it's a permanent reminder of the day when Ethiopia showed that it could, after all, resist the power of Europe, when Menelik's army in these mountains defeated an Italian invasion at the Battle of Adowa. The year was 1896, and the traditional Ethiopian painting tells the story of a modern awakening. It was the first time a European army had been defeated by Africans since Hannibal beat the Romans 2,000 years ago. Menelik's celebrations were huge and noisy. For days on end, the drink ran like water, and the tables were red with the blood of raw meat. In the rejoicing, the Ethiopians hardly noticed that they had still to pay a price for their independence. From now on, they would be enmeshed in the quarrels of the European powers. While the new ambassadors and their lady wives looked with astonishment at Menelik's medieval feasts, they were secretly seeking for allies here in the power struggle that was raging in Europe. Into this strange twilight world between yesterday and today, Haile Selassie was born. Now, after 80 years, he looks back on a lifetime that has spanned the gap between the 2,000 years of African tradition he inherited and our own jet-propelled international revolution that threatens to overwhelm him. One of his earliest memories is of the way our world first encroached on his, with the arrival in Ethiopia of the first British diplomatic mission to the court of his half-uncle Menelik. He was 5 years old. The year was 1897, just a year after the great victory of Adowa, and the British mission on its way to Addis Ababa stayed with the young Haile Selassie's father in the town of Harar. Harar then was a newly conquered province of Menelik's empire, taken from Muslim hands. Haile Selassie's father, Ras Makonnen, was Menelik's governor for Harar and a favorite to succeed to the throne. In Muslim hands, Harar had been a secret city, closed to non-Muslims for centuries. 40 years earlier, the British explorer Richard Burton had only been able to get here disguised as an Arab. He didn't think much of what he saw. The streets were stony and narrow, the faces were stern and secretive. He thought they justified the local proverb, hard as the heart of Harar. Harar's not a great deal better now, but for what change there is, Haile Selassie's father can take some credit. He allowed French priests to open this little mission school in the town and sent his son, Tafari Makonnen, to learn from them. 70 years later, French is still the only foreign language Haile Selassie speaks with any fluency. Today, the school is little changed, but in coming here as a boy, Haile Selassie recalls that he had an advantage given to very few others in the empire at that time, and he's been obsessed with the value of education ever since. His father is remembered by Haile Selassie as an unusually enlightened man. He built Harar's first hospital. He opened the first Ethiopian state school. And because he knew he might one day become emperor himself, and that Tafari would succeed him, he tried to prepare his son as best he could for the changes that he knew were bound to come from the traditional ways of the old world to the revolutionary demands of the new. So, throughout his boyhood, the young Tafari lived happily in his father's house, with a future that seemed secure. But suddenly, his father died, and Tafari passed at once from security into a world of medieval intrigue. He was only 13. Menelik was dying, paralyzed by a stroke. He had no son of his own, and with Ras Makonnen's death, the last chance of a clear succession had gone. His court was racked with the jealous plots of rivals for his throne. There was Taitu, his aging queen. Zauditu, his daughter, equally determined to get the throne herself. Ras Michael, a powerful provincial warlord, scheming to put his dissolute son and Menelik's nephew, Li Jiatu, on the throne. Against such plotters, the young Tafari had no chance. He was exiled as governor of another conquered province. Meanwhile, Menelik's palace seethed with treachery and murder, like the household of some African King Lear. For 5 years, the conspiracies tore the court apart, until in 1911, the doddering Menelik at last revealed his choice. Ras Michael's son, Li Jiatu, was the heir to his throne. The queen and his daughter were thrust aside, and Tafari Makonnen joined Ethiopia's other barons in swearing an oath of loyalty to his rival. As a reward, he was sent to his father's old job as governor of Harar. In Harar, Tafari was safely out of the way, a week's journey from the capital. He was just 19, but he was experienced far beyond his years. Already he knew not only how to run a province, but how to play a waiting game, and he knew there was still a crown to play for. He needed all his caution, because when Menelik died at last, and Li Jiatu was crowned, the new emperor was already half mad with syphilis, turning from youthful dissipation to exotic vice and murder. He tried to murder Tafari on this lake near Harar, where Tafari often went boating with friends. This time, Nijiatu bribed the servant to hold the boat so that it sank in the middle of the lake. The friend was drowned. Tafari survived by swimming ashore. The foreign embassies dabbled in these plots as well. The new diplomats who surrounded Menelik now imposed on these medieval intrigues the shape of approaching war in Europe.
All right, because we are going to have to wait to see that. Okay. Here go now.
Yes, this is the Cutting Edge on IRFM, where they play a documentary about Haile Selassie the First. And as we say, we know a whole heap of one know the documentary, but it is good to repeat these things in the head of these people, especially in Jamaica, yeah, where them thick-headed. We have to say this and repeat this documentary. And one of the good things about listening to this documentary that you don't ask Rastaman a stupid question. Because you know, say you have some people where I try to test you all the while, you know. They not test nobody else now. When they come to Rasta, they say, Rasta, so tell me something. Whenever I talk to Christian, man, them sweet and say, so what you saying, sir, that Jesus is the Savior and this and this and them not ask. So, when Rasta, tell me, say, no, Rasta, till I see a God. And so they talk to you, know, like without a sense. You know, feed them mind without a sense to you, know. Yeah. You have some like a civil servant out there, you know. Believe you me. It's a civil servant there. The people that work in a government office. And them people that can't take Rasta, you know. And them people that can't take Rasta. Believe you. I don't know if it's true it's a government thing, but I find, say, people who work in a tax office and government building and thing. I don't know what's wrong with them people there. Why they can't take way? They can't take Rasta. Them feel so we are idiot. Them feel so we have no sense. Yet still, when you look on the light of Jamaica yeah, right now, the light we are shine, we are glow outside of the earth there. A Rasta light a shine. So let the love light shine continuously. No matter what them want to say, we make the love light shine continuously. So, we're going to continue the journey as it is with this documentary. Before we go back to the documentary, you know, say, what a terrible thing. All right, make we do this. Because we have to do it.
He tried to murder Tafari on this lake near Harar, where Tafari often went boating with friends. This time, Nijiatu bribed the servant to hold the boat so that it sank in the middle of the lake. The friend was drowned. Tafari survived by swimming ashore. The foreign embassies dabbled in these plots as well. The new diplomats who surrounded Menelik now imposed on these medieval intrigues the shape of approaching war in Europe. Germany and Turkey stood with Nijiatu. Britain, France, and Italy swung to Tafari's side. It was 1914, and as the guns opened up on Europe's western front, 4,000 miles away, the contest in Ethiopia took an older shape. Christianity once again prepared for a clash with Islam. A Muslim empire in Africa was the bait dangled before Nijiatu by Germany and Turkey. And in his craze for power, the new ruler of a Christian empire became a Muslim in all but name. For the Christians, it was the last straw. Vice, murder, and rape they were accustomed to, but apostasy struck at the heart of their tradition. Nijiatu was formally excommunicated from the Ethiopian church, and with British encouragement, Tafari was proclaimed regent with the title of Ras, or prince. He was 24 years old. Lavitu, Menelik's daughter, was crowned empress at the same time. But the struggle was unfinished. Nijiatu was still free, and on this great plain north of Addis Ababa, his father, Ras Michael, gathered an army to restore him to the throne. It was another medieval scene. The horsemen were dressed in the monkey skins of war with Ras Michael at their head. On the other side, Rastafari's men gathered for battle in the same way. In Europe, the bloodiest of modern wars was being fought with tanks, machine guns, and poison gas. But here, ahead. On the other side, Rastafari's men gathered for battle in the same way. In Europe, the bloodiest of modern wars was being fought with tanks, machine guns, and poison gas. But here, the centuries rolled back as if to King Henry at Agincourt, or Richard losing his crown at Bosworth Field. Menelik's victory at Attawa. This battle of Ras Tafari for his crown has become one of the great subjects of Ethiopia's popular art. The battle lasted a full day, surging one way and then another. But in the end, the man who rode back to Addis Ababa in triumph was Ras Tafari. It was a victory that he still recalls as the turning point of his life. But almost immediately, he was embroiled in the outcome of the other war in Europe. At the Versailles Peace Conference in their victory, the Allies again redrew the map of Africa. But once more, Ethiopia escaped. Playing off the great powers against each other, Ras Tafari kept his independence. Joining the new League of Nations, he put his faith in the latest post-war watchword, collective security. In such great company, one little country would surely be safe, for none would let another gobble it up. Instead, he hoped that all might compete in helping him to modernize his country and make it worthy of its place in the League. To extend his foreign contacts, he toured the European capitals. In London, the Times described his arrival as an historical event. In Stockholm, he met King Gustav, and the Swedes promised him doctors. In Brussels, he found financiers ready to invest in his country. The French were already in Ethiopia. They had completed a railway from the coast to Addis Ababa in 1918. It was Ethiopia's first physical link with the modern world, and it helped to establish Addis as a permanent center of Ethiopian government, as no capital had ever been before. But Tafari still needed all the foreign help he could get. Most of Ethiopia was still sunk in the Middle Ages, and Addis Ababa was still only a ramshackle place of tin roofs and open drains. He had to fight poverty and tradition, but he was still only regent, and his hands were still tied by his old enemies at court, who were once more plotting against him. It wasn't until 1930 that Ras Tafari won supreme power at last and ascended the throne when the Empress Zaldito died. Crowned emperor at last at the age of 38, Tafari took the royal name of Haile Selassie, meaning the Mighty Trinity. The coronation was attended by men of rank and circumstance from all over the world. The Duke of Gloucester went from Britain. France sent a field marshal. Italy, the heir to the throne. Governors of Africa's colonial territories came to salute the independent African king. His own people poured into Addis Ababa in thousands to pay homage to the new emperor. At this moment, Ethiopia seemed about to be the first country in Black Africa to step hopefully into the modern world. Instead, the modern world marched almost at once into Ethiopia, far more brutally than before. Benito Mussolini, the Italian dictator, proclaimed he would create a new Roman Empire, and he aimed at the one place left for imperial conquest in Africa, Haile Selassie's Ethiopia. Mussolini's excuse was Ethiopia's backwardness, that same medievalism that Haile Selassie himself hoped to end. He told his soldiers they had a civilizing mission, but his ambitions dragged Haile Selassie straight into the 20th century's new barbarism. Hitler threatened the peace of Europe. As the Nazi troops marched, Western statesmen quailed at the thought of a new war.
No wars are horrible, and our kings are hot.
In the mouth of Ramsay MacDonald, Britain's Prime Minister, the age of appeasement was born. Its first sacrifice in the cause of peace in our time was to be the Emperor Haile Selassie. In Ethiopia, the Emperor could do no more than play for time against the Italian threat, winning the loyalty of the tribes and princes by a traditional mixture of prestige and bribery, and hoping that his old friends, Britain and France, would still come to his rescue. But Haile Selassie and his men were whistling in the dark. The Italian troops were already embarking, and Britain and France would do no more than proclaim an embargo on arms sales to both sides. For Italy, with her own arms, the embargo was a green light. For Ethiopia, it was a death sentence. But for Haile Selassie, the final betrayal came at the League of Nations. Pierre Laval, the French foreign minister, and Sir Samuel Hoare for Britain, proposed to hand part of Ethiopia to Mussolini. Appeasement had triumphed. Collective security was a myth. In the war that followed, Haile Selassie had no chance. Years earlier, Haile Selassie's father had helped Menelik to beat the Italians at Adowa. Now Mussolini's troops had their revenge. Within a month, Ethiopia's first capital at Aksum had fallen, and over 2,000 years of independence were nearly at an end. Abandoned by his international friends, Haile Selassie found even his own men unwilling to fight on. He had only a handful of trained troops, the rest were untrained tribal warriors, hopelessly outgunned. Before the Italian assault, the Emperor's army disintegrated. And at Easter 1936, Haile Selassie left his men to make a pilgrimage to the rock churches of Lalibela and to pray for his country. His prayers were unanswered. A month later, it was all over. In 8 months of steady advance, the Italians had lost only a few hundred men. Haile Selassie had lost an empire. On the 2nd of May, the age of appeasement was over. But as Europe went to war, appeasement's first victim seems more than ever forgotten. Only when the war widened still further was Haile Selassie remembered again. When Mussolini joined Hitler in 1940, the emperor automatically became Britain's ally, and his futile exile came to an end. Within weeks, Haile Selassie was back in Africa, waiting for the British to mount an invasion of his own country. The campaign was one of the swiftest and most successful of the war. In less than a year, the Italians were defeated and Haile Selassie was on his way back home. He flew into Ethiopia from the Sudan, and while other troops forced their way to Addis Ababa from the coast, he returned by road through the mountains. Just above Addis Ababa, he stopped for the first look at his capital, 5 years to the day since he had left it. What One imperial power had put asunder, another had restored. The legend of Solomon and Sheba was rekindled. The Lion of Judah had returned. Ethiopia rejoiced, and so did Haile Selassie. For him, it was one of the greatest moments of his life, a chance to start again. Thirty years later, in the grounds of his palace in Addis Ababa, where he takes his daily walk among the lions that symbolizes imperial power, he reflects now that at that moment of return, he was already 50 and had accomplished little. The Italians had left very few colonial improvements for him to build on. They'd only been there for 5 years, and they'd left things pretty much as before. There was no central administration. There certainly weren't any bright young graduates, there were no army officers, and there wasn't even a common language. Fundamentally, Haile Selassie was back with the same ramshackle empire he had won before, and whose primitive traditions he hadn't had a chance to scratch. Haile Selassie returned, his empire had 20 million people, 100 different tribes, and 50 different languages, and was twice the size of France. It was a proud empire, but its 2 or 3 thousand years of tradition underwrote poverty, disease, and ignorance. An empire where more than half the people were pagan or Muslim, yet were ruled by a Christian monarch, whose church was still the only source of unity. A secluded empire, where life had remained unchanged for centuries. An empire, in fact, as backward and conservative as anywhere in the world. There was no easy escape from the isolation and poverty of Haile Selassie's empire. There was no mineral wealth, no really modern economy of any kind. There weren't even any communications. The Italians had built a few roads, but the war had destroyed them again, and one of the first decisions the emperor had to make was whether he should rebuild the roads through these mountains. He decided he wouldn't, for the time being anyway. Instead, he put his faith in the air. With American help, he created a network of tiny airstrips that broke down the isolation of the interior for the first time. When the 1950s opened, Ethiopian Airlines were in business. It was Haile Selassie's first major accomplishment in modernizing his country. There was everything else still to be achieved. Yet at this moment, by a stroke of luck, Ethiopia's past for the first time came to the aid of the present and made Haile Selassie and his capital the focus of Africa's new hope. Almost the only independent African ruler after the war, Haile Selassie provided a symbol of self-respect for black men just emerging from white rule. The wind of change has come to Africa. Recognizing the emperor's unique position, the United Nations chose Addis Ababa as its African headquarters, and he embarked on a new political career.
The age in which we slave, your Imperial Majesty, is an age of paradox.
In his brand new Africa Hall, Haile Selassie presided at innumerable meetings of his new revolutionary colleagues. He became the great African father figure, the great African peacemaker, in the Congo, in Biafra, in Morocco and Algeria. It was a strange apotheosis for the King of Kings. He didn't always succeed, but his voice commanded respect, because he alone in Africa had been both victim and victor in the struggle against colonial rule. He alone had been the first martyr of the old League of Nations and was now a founder and guide of the new United Nations. Seeing his influence in the new Africa, the world beat a path to his door. The Organization of African Unity followed the United Nations and set up shop in Addis Ababa. Diplomats and businessmen flocked in. Within a decade, the face of Addis Ababa was transformed. The signs of international affluence towered over the old open drain. With the bankers and diplomats came foreign money and foreign aid. There were new ports, new roads, new dams to be opened. America trained the emperor's army. Russia built his schools. Israel provided technicians. India supplied teachers. Britain brought doctors. France offered culture. Germany sent trade missions. Haile Selassie's old empire had become the new African showcase, and everyone wanted an exhibit there. Today, Haile Selassie is besieged by foreign delegations hoping to catch his ear. He balances these contemporary forces to strengthen his own independence as shrewdly as he juggled half a century ago with the rival tribes and princes in his old fight for power. One day, it may be a Japanese delegation. The next day, a mission from Maoist China. It doesn't matter what political persuasion they are, they all see Haile Selassie as an essential link to the rest of Africa. At home or abroad, half his life seems consumed with ceremonial state visits, some of them purely political, some of them simply a tribute to his personal stature.
Okay. This is the Cutting Edge on IRFM. You're listening to a documentary on Haile Selassie's life, given that we can now say yesterday was his Earth Day. We will continue the journey.
Even with Italy, he's made friends again. On a state visit to Rome, 30 years after Mussolini's troops had been driven from his country. At home, he seems all-powerful, adding to the natural mystery of a divine monarchy the artificial cult of personality. His name is everywhere. His presence seems all-pervading. His word seems law. His ministers are overshadowed by him, and his government is run by him. His palace is surrounded by all the machinery of a modern administration. But even his prime minister brings the important decisions back to him. In his old age, it looks as if Haile Selassie has routed all his enemies at last, to emerge supreme, as if the all-wise and benevolent Lion of Judah has prevailed. Yet the one thing Haile Selassie has not prevailed over is his own country. Outside Addis Ababa, the traditional Ethiopian ways have hardly changed at all. The emperor's writ runs only as far as his governors can ride. Sometimes that may not be far enough. Less than a third of Haile Selassie's people live within a day's ride of any sort of road. It's over 60 years since Haile Selassie in his youth started his career as governor for the Emperor Menelik in this very province, and the system's no different for the man who represents him now. Every time the governor rides out into the farther reaches of his province, he gets a royal welcome. Selassie in the old days, the governor still needs guards to protect him, servants to tend him, even interpreters to translate for him, because hardly anybody in the remoter provinces speaks the language of the emperor's
government.
It's government in the medieval style, and modern Addis Ababa seems very far away. Even the bigger villages are centuries from the emperor's modern world. Only a quarter of his people use money for their trade, the rest barter in the local market. Out here, the emperor's law has to be simple and tough, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Every weekend you see gatherings like this scattered around the highland villages. It's a combination of detective inquiry and trial by jury, where all the men of the community are summoned by the emperor's commissioner to uncover a criminal. It's the village elders who make the investigation. The rest barter in the local market. Out here, the emperor's law has to be simple and tough, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Every weekend you see gatherings like this scattered around the highland villages. It's a combination of detective inquiry and trial by jury, where all the men of the community are summoned by the emperor's commissioner to uncover a criminal. It's the village elders who make the investigation. If they can't agree on a culprit, every man present will suffer his share of a collective punishment. If the finger points to one man, he can expect short shrift. In every village market place, the public gallows still waits for the murderer or the rebel. But what law for the poor in Haile Selassie's empire is less often law for the rich? The Ethiopian parliament is the emperor's own creation, a little nudge of his people towards constitutional government. But it twice refused to pass the emperor's own land reform law because its members won't give away their own privileges. As the years go by, the emperor's step gets slower. He may live in some splendor himself, but he knows the Ethiopian peasant is still as poor as any in Africa. Yet he's paralyzed by the traditions he's inherited from 2,000 years ago. Landlords and princes dominate his parliament and hold the countryside in fee. The peasants own nothing. And at harvest time, the landlords and their bailiffs come to demand their share of the crop. Landlords may not be as powerful as they used to be, but like the barons of feudal England, they're still strong enough sometimes to hold even the monarch at bay, still strong enough to hold the people in complete subservience. Biggest of all the landlords is the Ethiopian church. History has made it inseparable from the empire, and now, as powerful as the great monastic orders of medieval Europe, it dominates the life of the Christian highlands. The church is the cross, but is also the nation's salvation, both a reactionary burden and a civilizing influence. Its priests may be ignorant, but they're usually the only people for miles around who can read or write. Its schools are pathetic. But until Haile Selassie's reign, few other schools existed. 90% of his people remained totally illiterate. Yes! population of Ethiopia now is under the age of 15. And for Haile Selassie, their education has always been an obsession. He's taken personal charge of the Ministry of Education, sourced teachers and money for more schools from half the countries in the world, and turned one of his palaces into a university. He's directly responsible for whatever schooling these youngsters get. But like everywhere else, the more they have, the more they want. School strikes and revolutionary slogans take command. And Haile Selassie's efforts are dismissed by the young as mere failure and repression. The educated middle-aged are rebellious too. They owe their privileges to the emperor as much as to anyone, but they whisper their discontent in the posh bars of Addis every night and can't wait for the old man to go. But the old man's still there, as shrewd and ruthless as ever. He still knows how to balance one force against another, playing off traditional resentments against novel discontents. Some of the latest challenges to Haile Selassie's rule combine the old and the new Ethiopian divisions of discontents. Down near the coast in Eritrea, where the Italians had their empire for half a century, there's a popular liberation front now fighting for independence from Haile Selassie and joining the old battle of Islam against Christianity with a new revolutionary movement against an ancient monarchy. The emperor can send his army to deal with that. But it hasn't always been easy for him to deal with his army. His soldiers now are a far cry from the barefoot rabble that Mussolini's men destroyed nearly 40 years ago, and farther still from the medieval cavalry that won him his crown 20 years before that. But only 10 years ago, some of his soldiers tried to throw him out, and very nearly succeeded. It could happen again. The classic 20th century military coup d'etat against an aging ruler. Haile Selassie is a lonely man now. His wife, two sons, a daughter are all dead, and though others remain to keep him company now and then, the essential solitude of his life on the tightrope of power must grow more oppressive every year. On one side, there's still the old Ethiopian world of feudal power and tradition. On the other, there's the new challenge of his own reforms, the educated youngsters and the modern army officers who want the world and would like it now. They're the upper and never millstones which have ground many a good man, especially in this century. To have survived them for the better part of 55 years in power is something unequaled by any ruler in the world today. No wonder the Lion of Judah has become one of the living legends of our time.
As the smoke is driven away,
Listening to Mutabaruka.
His Imperial Majesty, Emperor Haile Selassie. His Imperial Majesty, Emperor Haile Selassie. Lightning and thunder, brimstone and fire.
Here I, Ras Tafari, His Majesty, African drums, Naya Bingi drums, carving out my existence. Drums, more drums, catapulting me through time. I hear the ancestors, I am my ancestors, reliving, redefining Africa, the way, the truth, the light. Abyss, Rastaman, existing through the world.
You are listening to Mutabaruka.
Celebration, it's still going on. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM, celebrating Emperor Haile Selassie's Earth Day, 1892, the 23rd of July. Yes. Deborah Reese coming through, traveling, man. So after them say Haile Selassie dead, them things said the whole thing would have just crumble. 1975, them things say that it done, but guess what, just a come, all it do is just get stronger and stronger and stronger. Cutting Edge, yes, blessed.
Yeah. Yes, blessed. Yes, right, yes, Mota. Yeah, greetings. Man, yeah. Yes, man. Mandingo phoning in from London, and full joy in the music that they are playing,
yeah,
with respect to the 122nd Earth Strong of His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie.
Mm-hmm.
And yesterday there were a lot of functions all over Britain by Rastas,
yes,
and those who support the idea that we must celebrate our heroes, our kings, yeah, and our, yeah, sheroes.
We can't allow them to tell you who to celebrate.
Precisely. We define who we celebrate,
mm-hmm,
definitely.
Mm-hmm.
And there were some functions. And here you're playing the crucial Bunny Wailers tune, and Bunny Wailers is in London, as it is. In,
yeah,
fact, he has a show in Brighton tonight.
Oh,
and
yeah?
On Sunday, he's going to... Yes, he has a show in Brighton tonight, Thursday night. And on Sunday, he's going to be performing at the Electric, formerly known as the Fridge in Brixton.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that will be...
Want to the Brixton Academy. Want to Brixton, show. Want to Brixton Academy. Not there again.
Yes, it still exists. But they call it the Brixton O2 now. That has a capacity of a little over 5,000.
Brixton O2?
Yes.
Then they don't have an O2. Them now have an O2 out of, which power would play the other day? No, O2 that too.
Well, we did that. Yes, that is an O2. Because you have O2s all over the country.
Oh. All right.
That
never know that.
That is a chain of O2. So
never know that.
Yes, that have a capacity bigger than the one that we were at that time. Over 5,000. Mm. But the Electric Cinema... The Electric, that used to be known as the Fridge in Brixton, where, mm, Bunny Wailer will be performing this,
yeah,
Sunday,
yeah,
the 27th of July, 2017. That has a capacity of about 1,600.
Okay.
And the other day, Ziggy Marley worked there,
yeah,
with his drummer, Santa, Carlton Davis.
Yeah, man, you should play with me too, Santa, yeah.
Right, yes. My drummer too, because I play upon several of my
productions. So, how that show did it go with Steve, with Ziggy Marley?
Sold out.
Yes,
it was sold out, and I also expect the Bunny Wailer show to also be sold out.
Well, that's 1,600, you know, 1,600. Yeah.
Yes. You know, without a doubt.
I hear that Marcia Griffiths have come up too. I should come up already.
No, it says sometime in September.
Okay.
I see some advertisement.
50th anniversary.
Yes, and the bill is like Bob Andy, I see, as one of the names, which is only natural.
Yes,
since,
yes,
he's the one who wrote those original hits for
Long time,
Studio,
yeah,
One,
yeah,
and so on.
Yeah.
Yes, truly and truly.
She have one out in November, you know. She have a celebration out in November. A big 50th anniversary. Yeah, she have a celebration out in November with all of the artists them where she record with. 50 artists she put on the bill.
So you know what that look like? Because she just did that in the States the other day. So
yeah, but
like
she never had the 50
she
artists.
Doing all. So it's like she doing all and then going to be doing...
Yeah, November birthday. Yeah, November birthday.
Yes. Yes, November woman.
Mm.
Yes, just like my mother.
Yeah.
But that should also be good.
Yeah.
That should also be good, without a doubt. But I see the advertisement for that year for sometime in September.
Okay.
And thing. But people really looking forward to the Bunny Wailer show
and right now
at the,
yeah,
Electric this Sunday. Because years he hasn't performed here, you know.
Okay.
And as the prominent surviving founder Wailer, you know,
people
really look forward, and is a man as I know, not only sings but speaks his mind, whether you agree with him or not. Not, you know, so that will be going well. And preparations for the march on Friday the 1st of August, starting at Windrush Square by Brixton, going to Houses of Parliament to hand in a petition demanding reparations. Preparations for that are going very well.
Mm.
And one of the important things with that is the security aspect, because we are quite aware that you will have some agent provocateurs, troublemakers who will come to so-called join the march in order to disrupt it and thing to give the whole thing a bad name. So,
mm,
one of the key things that we've seen about is security.
Yeah.
You know, definitely that has to be done. And I am pleased that I was selected by the people, the Ida Mandingo, to be helping out where that is concerned, to and being as one of the spokespersons for the reparation march in terms of publicizing it, you know. And we give thanks because I think you sent something with regards to promotion of the reparation march.
The British did ask me to lend my voice to a promotion, so I did it, and same of it.
Yes, that is Prophet Jabi.
So
we're saying up front for the world to hear, listening, that we give thanks for your support in adding your voice to this campaign.
Yes.
Because it will be an annual thing, Mutabaruka. You know, it's good, and but it's more than ironic that as two Kingston Technical High School man, that different sides of the Atlantic, but we're doing the work, which is what Marcus Garvey said.
Make I ask you a question. Don't them have a celebration for Marcus Garvey's birthday?
Yes, there is on the 17th. As a matter of fact, I have been asked to be the main speaker on Marcus Garvey's birthday, the 17th of August, in Birmingham.
Okay.
By a Pan-African group here to be the main speaker on Marcus Garvey's birthday to speak about Marcus Garvey.
Cecil Godsmore involved with one there, where them did ask me if I come, them did I invite me, but I don't hear from them again.
Yes, well,
you know who named Cecil
Godsmore? Yes, man, I know Cecil Godsmore, man. Yes, you know, I know Cecil Godsmore.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know how that went. What cause, whatever, but he's not part of the group,
the Birmingham,
that invited me to speak in Birmingham, you know, and so on. But that went very, very, very well. And of course, the 20th, which was Sunday, I listened to the entire program, and I want the world to know totally support what you said when you were speaking, and Omar Davis was trying to counteract you. In fact, he got upset.
I totally support what you said
because you spoke the truth.
To me, same disconnect.
Yes, I think he's trying to get it wrong.
Him think I that about disconnection from him constituency. You see, them so local, you know. Them so local.
Precisely.
Them not think so. When you said disconnect, me talk about disconnect from the African things them we are go around him, the struggle we are take place outside of him little constituency. That is what me talk about when me say disconnect. Him disconnect because him they talk about Vietnamese and this a struggle and
precisely
that struggle and a link
and, with and Chinese and that type of thing.
Yeah.
But listen. But he's totally disconnected, not just in terms of the wider African community. He's disconnected with the African youths in his community too, because I'm called some of them irredeemable. That's on record.
Yeah, a long time him said that. But, you know, but me just said that, say,
yes.
When me did that term disconnected, me never talk about disconnected. You know, I mentioned 21 years. 21 years, yes. The truth say, him not disconnected, but Him totally
but you were not talking about that disconnection.
No, that means that talk about. I talk about disconnection from the African struggle. We unilaterally sometimes go out there, but seek certain little levels to make certain things. We're not talking about the plane flight. The plane flight and visa and all them things that where African people need to go to Africa and them something there. And that we are talking about. We're not talking about no little constituents around us, so where him have people and this and that and Dan man and this and that. You know?
Exactly. But I knew, and a lot of people listening knew, that was what you meant. But it goes to show that what you said is true, because he's totally disconnected. Because if he was connected, he would have overstood what you were talking about.
Yes. Anyway, we have to move though.
I'm glad you brought it to the fore.
You want to call me back tomorrow, we talk about it. Call me back tomorrow, we talk about it. Later.
Alright, upon the stepping razor.
Yeah, call me back later. Call the Bridging Comfing program and now we have to move. Give thanks, Bridging.
Alright then, give thanks. Yeah, blessed man. Love people from the Mandingo to all Africans.
Yeah, so we say, give thanks to the moment. Give thanks to the time. Give thanks to the energy. You know, so we will be back here from 2 to 5:45 with the Stepping Razor, The Art of War. Totally different program. Matrix in the house again, looking like a skinhead. I tell you, man look like a skinhead. He is doing everything. Ballet shine up on everything. I tell you, man, skinhead out of the book. So we say give thanks to the moment, give thanks to the time, give thanks to the energy.